Praise God. Just close your eyes just a moment. As you close your eyes, just repeat after me, Jesus. Do it again, Jesus. Jesus. I confess you as my Savior and as my Lord. I invite you into my life. I surrender my life to you. May your will be my will. Will you cover me with your blood? Protect me with the power of your Holy Spirit. And lead me through life. Help me experience, in Jesus' name, abundant life. And I thank you for it. Amen. 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 Well, this day and this hour and this moment in our lives, we need to boldly stand up and confess Jesus Christ as Lord of Lords and King of Kings and as Almighty God. Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. And we need to believe in Him with all our hearts. We need to believe that He has prepared a place for us. And let me tell you, that place is a better place than this place.
Yes,
amen? And we need to have confidence that He is on His way, that He has made a way, and that we can put our trust in Him. Amen? You know, the Bible says God's not given us a spirit of fear, but a power and love and a sound mind. And we need to put our faith in Him and realize, wow, that He's more than enough to take care of us. He's more than enough to watch over us. He's more than enough to be that covering and that dwelling place where we find safety, that He's the strong tower, and we can trust in Him. Amen? Take your Bible and turn to Psalms 91. And we're going to talk a little bit more about Psalms 91 and this place of shelter, this place of safety. And let me just read it to you again. I love Psalms 91. I hope you have it on your refrigerators and where you can see it and where you can read it and pray it over your lives and over your home and your family. It says, "He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. And I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him I will trust. Surely He will deliver you from the snare of the fowler, from the perilous pestilence. He shall cover you with His feathers, and under His wing you shall take refuge. His truth will be your shield and buckler. You shall not be afraid of the terror by night, nor the arrows that fly by day, nor the pestilence that walk in darkness, nor the destruction that lays waste at noonday." Listen to this next verse. "A thousand may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not come near you. Only with your eye shall you look and see the reward of the wicked. Because you have said, 'The Lord is my refuge.' Even the Most High has become your dwelling place. No evil shall befall you, nor shall any plague come near your dwelling. For He shall give His angels charge over you to keep you in all your ways. And in their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. You shall tread upon the lion and the cobra, the young lion and the serpent. You shall trample underfoot. God speaks because He has set His love upon me. Therefore I will deliver him. I will set him on high. He has known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him, and I will be with him in trouble, and I will deliver and honor him with long life. I will satisfy him and show him my salvation." Isn't that a powerful passage of Scripture? And wow, we need to make that a confession in our lives. And, you know, that passage of Scripture was written during the 40 years of wilderness wandering and the dangerous times that they were facing and all the struggles. And yet God was their shield of protection. Yeah, I was thinking about that. Can you imagine when God literally led the Israelites out of captivity from the Egyptian, one of the most powerful nations in the world, and God literally dismantled them. And yet when they was coming out, Pharaoh rallied together and decided that he was going to wipe them out. And guess what? God put a shield. And you know what? It was light to the children of Israel, and it was a cloud of darkness to the Egyptians who could not penetrate that. Now, how many of you believe God could do that then? He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He can do it today. And so I want us to keep our focus on what God in store. You know, as we deal with the pandemic and we deal with the impact that it's had upon our communities and around the world, guys. And, you know, a lot of people, you know, they're wondering what's going to happen, whether we'll ever find a normal way of life again and all these different things. But how many realize in the midst of all of that, God is our refuge. God is our fortress. God is that strong tower of safety, and that we put his trust in him. I want you to think about this. I looked this up, and I printed it. You know, when you think about this, you know, everybody, you know, is kind of wondering, where are we? You know, what's going to happen? Is Jesus getting ready to come? Are we coming down to the end times and all of that? Let me just say this to you before I go any farther. I'd get ready. I'd make sure I'm ready. I'd make sure I'm forgiven of my sins. I'd make sure that I have a good relationship with him. I'd make sure that I'm in tune with what God is doing. And, you know, this is not a time to run away. This is a time to draw near. Amen. This is a time to be able to look to him and say, God, you are my shield. You are my protection. And I want to trust in you. Now, here's what God done in the past. Would you like to know what God's done in the past? Sometimes, how many realize, and that's another thing, guy, it's a crazy world. We want to rewrite our past, but it's past. And you know, you can't rewrite your past. The neat thing about God is he can forgive you of your past and put you on the right direction for life and life in its abundance, okay? But here's, if you look at what God's done in the past, and then you think about him being a shield. You think about him being a covering for your life. You think about him being protection, and you'll discover how God did that throughout the books of the Bible, from Genesis to Revelation. Listen to this, and you you can jot these down or you can think about them. But God sheltered Noah and his family for 1 year in the ark until Noah emerged to become the father of all the nations of the world. That's pretty heavy, isn't it? That God sheltered him and his family in that ark. God sheltered Jacob in the home of his uncle Laban when he needed to escape the wrath of Esau, his brother. 20 years later, Jacob emerged with a new family, new wealth, and new identity. He became Israel, the new name for God's chosen people. Pretty heavy. God protected him. God had a way and God had a plan, all right? God sheltered Joseph from his 17th year to his 30th year, but his slavery and prison became the school where God prepared him for greatness. God sheltered Moses in a remote desert for 40 years, but Moses came forth to liberate the Jewish people from Egypt. God sheltered Naomi in the barren land of Moab until she nearly became bitter, but she and her daughter-in-law, Ruth, traveled to Bethlehem to participate in one of the greatest love stories of history. God sheltered David for 15 years after he had been anointed king of Israel, and when David finally assumed the throne, he was a man after God's own heart and became a great leader. Wow. God sheltered Jonah 3 days and three nights in the belly of a whale. And when the sheltering was over, Jonah went to Nineveh and preached history's greatest revival. You know why it was history's greatest? They all repented. Yeah. That's pretty heavy, isn't it? They all repented. Well, God sheltered Esther while she was in the palace of the Persian king, and she saved her people from destruction. God sheltered the disciples in an upper room for 10 days until the Holy Spirit descended in dramatic fashion to form and fashion the church that we know and experience today. Isn't that pretty heavy? I mean, the list could go on. All of these people were in difficult situation. God sheltered Paul in the Arabian desert for 3 years, and when he emerged from his solitude, he turned the world upside down for Jesus. I mean, the list goes on and on. But all of these ingredients, think about this. God sheltered John on the island of Patmos. And guess what came out of that? The book of Revelation. Isn't that pretty heavy? So what is God trying to say to us in the year 2020? What is God trying to get our attention to? And how can we look to Him? Because when you read Psalms 91, how many realize God is a God of guidance? He guided these people through all of their difficult times. How many believe God can guide us through our difficult times? Amen? And I believe that as we put our trust in Him and we choose to seek Him as our shelter and our refuge, that God will guide us, that God will direct our steps, that God will, you know, the enemy's out there to set traps, but how many believe God's more wise than the enemy, more powerful than the enemy, and He can guide us around the traps. He can work, just like Carolyn almost falling and that lady reaching out and catching her. I believe that's God taking care of His people. Amen? And you need to realize that and realize that no matter how difficult, that we can begin to keep our eyes focused on God, and He will lead us, you know, from deception, distraction, and He will lead us into victory. And how many realize that victory includes a place called heaven? Amen. Isn't that pretty neat? I want you to keep that in mind. Because if we are approaching the end times, if these are wake-up calls and notices that God's trying to get our attention, guess what? We need to focus on the attention that God has a place prepared for us. And He says, in that place, there's many, many mansions. Can you imagine streets of gold, gates of pearl? All of those ingredients are all things that God is saying, hey, it may be tough, but I've got a better place for you, amen? And so He's a God of guidance. He's a God that will help and He will direct you. And it says, my favorite scripture says, trust in the Lord with how much of your heart and lean not to your own understanding. Guys, I want you to understand something here. That we need to look to God because we may be facing difficult times and we may be struggling in some of our community, but I want you to know if you'll trust God, not try to figure it out on your own, but let God begin to direct your steps. You know what He says? He'll make a way of life. He'll make plain the walk of life. He'll give you direction because He is a God of guidance. And that's what He was trying to say as the Psalms 91 was written, that we can trust Him to deliver us. And can you imagine? He says, 1,000 to one side, 10,000, but it will not come near you. In other words, how many realize that He's able to guide us through this corona situation and give us victory? And here's the thing. You know what? They're searching for a vaccination. They're searching for something that they can give help us defeat this. But how many realize, I think Jesus is the vaccination. How many believe that? I believe when we put our trust in Him, He becomes that shield, that protection. He becomes that tower of safety. And when we look to Him, He says, we can dwell in this secret place and He covers us over. And it becomes a cloud of protection. It becomes like an old mother hen protecting her little chickens that we are covered over. And let me tell you what, no power of the enemy, no power of darkness, no devil, no demon can penetrate that covering. Amen? So I think we ought to choose to say, wow, I want His vaccination. I want to experience His power. I want to experience His covering. I want to experience all that God is doing. And you know what? I think it makes us immune from the disease. No disease will come near your dwelling place. Amen? Now, you know, let me put a negative in here. The consequence, if you do not trust in Him, is the danger that you will be run over by the devil, run over by the enemy. So, you know, listen to what it says. And to me, this is one of the saddest passages of Scripture. And it's talking about Israel, in Jerusalem. And it's in Psalms 23, in verse 37 through and 38, it says, Jesus said, O Jerusalem, O Jerusalem, how often I wanted to gather you, your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wing, but you were not willing. See, your house is left desolate. Can you imagine? They knew not the day of their visitation. They knew not Jesus as the Messiah. They rejected the very one that God sent to be their deliverer. They rejected the very Messiah that they looked for. And you know, one of that passage of Scripture, he wept when he looked over Jerusalem because he said they knew not the day of their visitation. Let me tell you something, guys. And you need to hear this loud and clear. God may be trying to get our attention with this coronavirus. And what we need to do in getting our attention is we need to turn to Him and look to Him like we've never looked before. We need to put our trust in Him like we've never put before. And we need to say, God, we believe You are the God that's more than enough. And that You can guide us. That You can be the vaccination. You can be the covering. And we trust in You. Now, I used the Scripture at the very beginning. God has not given us a spirit of fear. How many of you believe that? God doesn't operate in fear. God operates in power and love and grace and kindness. He says God's not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and love. How many realize He loves you, guys? How many realize He wants to wrap you up in His arms, in His safety, in His protection? And you know what? He's not given us a spirit of fear, but a power of love and a sound mind. I've come through this thing over and over. We need the wisdom of God, and we need to have a sound mind, a good mind in making good decisions. Because if you let fear grip you, guess what? Fear will grab a hold of you, and you'll make poor decisions. So we need to realize the power of God in this, and we need to realize that God loves you, and no matter what you've done, where you've been, what you've said, what you've done, God never stops loving you. And God will always be a God of forgiveness, and God will always be a God that gives His wisdom. He says, if any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God, and He will give liberally to those who ask. Can you imagine what we need to be doing? We need to be seeking God for His wisdom and for His guidance through this thing. And we need to get His direction in what He's doing and trust Him to do that. Now, the next thing, how many of you believe He's a God of miraculous protection? I mean, all these things I read to you, would you agree they were miraculous protection? Can you imagine when Moses was running for his life, God had a place of protection for him? When Jonah was in rebellion, God had a place of protection for him that changed his heart, and he went and was one of the greatest revivals ever held. I mean, the list goes on and on through all these ingredients, but God is a miraculous God. Can you imagine Noah and his family going in an ark and God taking care of them for a year, and then he become the father of nations? I mean, the list goes on and on. Can you imagine before he led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he had the Passover lamb and the blood was applied. And guess what? It was a shield of protection for them. Amen? And God literally led those Israelite people out. Well, let me tell you. I believe one of the things that we're approaching, and one of the things that I believe is drawing closer every day, and it's called the rapture. How many of you really realize that is God's deliverance? Amen? That's God's deliverance. And that's God saying that my wrath is going to come up on this world. But my blood-bought people, I've got a place for them. And I want you to listen to this because I think this is pretty neat that we need to read this. In 1 Thessalonians, the 5th chapter, starting with verse 9, it says, for God did not appoint us to wrath. Now, I want you to think about that. God didn't appoint the churches to wrath. Why didn't he appoint the church for the wrath? Because God is a God of deliverance. God is a shield, a covering. And when we believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, he says, I prepared a place for you, a place of protection, a place that will be away from the wrath of God that is poured out upon this old world. And so we listen to it. He says, I didn't appoint you unto to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we awake or asleep, we should live together with him. Therefore, comfort each other and edify one another, just as you are doing. Now, in light of that, take your Bible and go back one chapter in 1 Thessalonians. Let me get there. In the fourth chapter, okay? Everybody's probably ahead of me. 1 Thessalonians, the fourth chapter. And listen to what it says. Let's start with verse 13. It says, but I do not want you to be unlearned, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. How many have a hope? What's your hope? Jesus. What's your hope? Jesus. What's your hope of eternal life? It's Jesus. We have a hope, amen? So listen to what it says. Lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout and with the voice of an archangel and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. Now, listen to what he says in the next verse. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. How many realize, even in the worst crisis, that ought to be a comfort, that God has got a better play, that God is coming to deliver us, that he says you're not appointed under wrath. Okay? Now, when you think about this message, and I want you to listen to this next little bit that I'm getting ready to share with you. One of the promises of the Scripture, how many remember Abraham? And if you read in Genesis, this is the 12th chapter. God reveals himself to Abraham. And God begins to speak and develop a relationship with Abram, who became Abraham. And what he told Abraham, he said, I want you to get out of the land. And I want you to go to a place, a special place called Canaan. And, you know, a lot of people think, well, maybe he was talking about heaven. But let me tell you what. He was talking about a piece of land in the Middle East. Okay? And that land was a promise, a gift in Abraham's obedience that he would follow God and that God would lead them to the promised land. And they would possess a segment of land in the Middle East. Can you imagine? 2,000 years later, guess what? The center of interest in the world is this little piece of land that Jerusalem sets in. And this land is a turmoil, a battlefield. And yet God has promised Abraham, and let me tell you, that they would inherit that land. Now God tried everything to get the attention of his Israelite people. Guess what? They were a stiff-necked, hard-nosed, rebellious group of people. That's terrible to say, but when you look at the Jewish people, their history, they were stiff-necked, they were rebellious, they rejected many offers of God to direct their steps. And when it comes to the New Testament, God revealed the message of the Messiah to the Jewish people to give them one more chance. Now listen to what I'm saying. And they rejected him. They fought him. They crucified him. They nailed him to a cross. Kind of an interesting thing, isn't it? And what I want you to understand, though, in the midst of all of that, God had a covenant promise to Abraham. And one day he says, they will possess the land. One day they will dwell in the land, and Messiah, the one they rejected, will be the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the Almighty God. Now let me tell you something. What you need to understand, the reason I believe in a rapture, the reason I believe that it is a dwelling place of safety, because God is going to take the church out. And while God has got the church out and they're going through the wedding ceremony in heaven, guess what he's going to do? He is going to set up 7 years of tribulation, and that tribulation will be the final wrath that will come up on Israel. And at the end of it, they will believe on their Messiah, and the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords will come through the sky, and we'll be with him, and he'll take control. And for 1,000 years, the promise of Abraham will be fulfilled. They will possess the land. Isn't that something? That's a quick rap story, but that's how it's happened. And that's the reason the tribulation has got to come, because it will be the final battle that will be won by the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And guess what? The Jewish people who survive will acknowledge him as the Messiah. Isn't that pretty cool? Isn't that pretty heavy? But it all started over a covenant promise of a piece of land. And that piece of land, can you imagine, all these years later, is the focal point of our world? A focal point of what's happening. And can you imagine, 1948. I was 1 year old. Carolyn was just being born. 1948. 1948, Israel bloomed as a nation. Isn't that pretty heavy? 1948, and God is starting to fulfill his promise to Abraham, his covenant to Abraham. I'll gather my people back. I'll bring them back. And you know what? Can you imagine? Nobody believed that Israel would become a nation. Guess who the first person was to acknowledge Israel as a nation? Anybody have an idea? What was the United States? The President of the United States was sitting in the Oval Office waiting for the speech to be made. And as the speech was being made, he sent a telegram saying, congratulations to the Israelite people becoming a nation. And let me tell you something, guys. God chose Israel as his nation. He gave them covenant promises, and God is faithful, and he'll fulfill those covenant promises. And something that we need to pray for more than ever, I believe God has blessed America because of that phone or that telegram being sent, and that we have been a supporter of Israel all through the ages. And we need to pray for our leaders and our congressmen and our senators to never forsake that responsibility, because also there is a history of nation after nation that rebelled and turned against Israel and literally faced destruction and devastation. So we need to constantly believe that God is a God that supports Israel, and we have a responsibility to support Israel and be a part of that support. Amen? You know, can you imagine? Our salvation, guys, is through the Jewish people. Our salvation is through the birth of Jesus Christ. Our salvation and all of these good ingredients are because of what God has done through the Jewish people. And you know, you need to realize God is a God of covenant, and he's a God who fulfills his covenant relationships. This is why I think it's so important that we have a wake-up call. You know, listen to what this passage of Scripture says, and I think this is probably one of the most powerful passages of Scripture that speaks to where we're at in this day and age. Let me see if I can find it back in my notes. Just take your Bible and turn to, I can't find it there, but I can find it in my Bible. Hebrews. I hate that when my mind goes blank and I can't find my notes. It's forsake not the assembling together. Somebody help me here. Well, what did I do with that passage of Scripture? Does anybody remember the it's Hebrews... I want to say, is it 10? I actually printed that passage of Scripture out the morning so I'd have it.
Hebrews 10:25.
Okay, back up, and it's 10:25. Back up, let me see if I can get there. Oh. Yeah. Okay. All right. Sorry, guys. That was this start with verse 19, okay? I want you to hear this. No. Therefore, brethren, having boldness to enter the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way which he consecrated for us through the veil, that is, his flesh, and having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as is the manner of some, but exhorting one another so much more as you see the day approaching. Now think about this. Here we are talking about dwelling in the secret place of the Most High. We have the revelation of Israel becoming a nation in 1948. You have the parable of the fig tree. Remember the parable of the fig tree? And the end of that parable of that fig tree, it says, this generation shall not pass away until the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Israel was always figured as the fig tree. And when that fig tree bloomed, it bloomed in 1948 when nobody thought it would ever bloom. When nobody thought it would ever come back, it bloomed as a nation in 1948. And it says that generation will not pass away until the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. How many believe we could be drawing close? If that statement is a powerful statement that is true, that when Israel bloomed as a nation, bloomed as a fig tree, and you know, what was it that Jesus did to the fig tree when it should have had blooms on it? He cursed it, didn't he? So now, instead of cursing it, he is blessing it, and it is blooming as a nation. Can you imagine that there's about 6 million people in Israel? 6 million. Smaller than Chicago. But do you realize that God has caused Israel to bloom since 1948, and it's one of the most powerful nations in the Mideast? Isn't that pretty heavy? And it's one of the most brilliant group of people that's been the most creative people, that they've literally bloomed as a nation. I mean, they have developed, and all of the treasures and resources have been made known in this little piece of property that God promised as a covenant through Abraham. Now think about this. So if this is true, and what we're dealing with, he says, as you see the day approaching, as you see these things starting to happen, so shouldn't it have our attention that Israel bloomed as a nation in 1948? Shouldn't have our attention that the whole world is focusing on this little piece of property? Shouldn't it have our attention that even with the corona epidemic, with all of the difficulty, the chaos and the confusion of our world, our world seems to be falling apart at the seams. People are turning on one another, and all the crisis, the craziness of trying to destroy and rewrite our history, all of these different things are all signs that we are approaching the end times, that we are approaching the coming of our Lord Jesus. And so here's what he says. Don't turn loose of this hope. I mean, hold fast to your confession. Hold fast to your beliefs. And encourage one another. Build one another up. Support one another. Come together. And this is the time not for the church to dismantle. And guess what the world's trying to do right now? It's literally trying to dismantle. And let me tell you, the devil, he comes as a roaring lion seeking him who he may devour. Not only that, he is a devil of deception. Now think about this. It sounds very meaningful and to be responsible and, you know, not like you don't care that, okay, we've got an epidemic. And this epidemic is very contagious. This epidemic is very deceiving. You can be carrier of it and not even have any symptoms. That's pretty deceiving, isn't it? Okay? And so everybody wants to fit in, so we talk about closing down the churches. We talk about having limitations of what we could do. But now all of a sudden, they're saying we can't sing in church. All of a sudden, all these new requirements and all these restrictions are starting to come. And all of a sudden, I begin to think, wait a minute. The devil in his deception, if he can shut the churches down, he thinks he'll win. All right? And this is why we need to make a stand in these last days. We need the wisdom of God. We need the wisdom of God. We need to respect, you know, one another and protect one another. But the fact of it is, in this day and age, we need to make a stand for the Lord Jesus Christ. In this day and age, we need to unite together because it says, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together. Encourage one another. Build one another up. Support one another. Encourage one another. Hold fast your confession of faith. Because let me tell you what, he could split the sky before Monday comes. Amen? He could come before we see Monday. And he's coming for people who are looking for his return, expecting him to come, looking with great anticipation that he's coming to take us to a secret place. You know what? He says, I am the way. And nobody will come to my Father except through me. He says, I am the door in John 10. I am the way. Guys, we need to make a stand in these last days. And we need to step up and say, God, I want to draw closer to you than I've ever drawn before. I want to get acquainted more than I've ever got acquainted. I want to be in your will. Because I don't know about you guys, but I want to be in that rapture. I want to be, if it's going to be 7 years of wrath, and this is just a wake-up call to coronavirus, can you imagine what those 7 years will be like? Can you imagine? the devastation of it all. Now, here's my bottom line. Bottom line, are you ready? Have you peace in your heart that if he came before Monday, come, that you'd be ready to meet him in the air? Let not your hearts be troubled. The reason they're not be troubled is because you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, that you're ready for his return, that you're ready to hear the voice of the archangel and the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise. For the most lively place in the neighborhood will be the cemetery. Yeah. Can you imagine that? The liveliest place? Can you imagine them graves busting open and out of there come? And then while you're watching that, immediately you're transformed and you're with them in the air. Kimmy, when she was a little girl, we'd talk about this. And she said, "Mommy, I don't know how to fly. Can I fly on your back?" "I don't know how to fly." "Well, you know what? I know how to fly. You put your trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. And you dwell in that secret place of the Most High. And guess what? You'll get to meet him. What a day that will be." Amen? What a day that will be. When my Jesus I shall see, and he takes me by the hand, he leads me through that promised land. What a glorious day that will be. Let's stand together, guys. Well. As you stand with me, guys, it says, "Because he has set his love up on me, he will therefore deliver me." How many of you believe that? He set his love upon us, and I believe he will deliver us, and he will take care of us. With your heads bowed, your eyes closed a moment. You know, it's a personal decision. It's a decision that each one of us has to make individually. And as you have your heads bowed and your eyes closed, I want you to ponder in your heart, ponder in your thoughts, am I ready? Have I made the decision to surrender my heart, my life to the Lord Jesus Christ? And do I believe that he is the way, the truth, and the life? Do I believe that he is the doorway into this place called heaven, a place that's been prepared for those who believe in him and trust him? You know, the thing about that is, it's no farther away from you than a prayer of repentance and saying, "God, I'm sorry. I ask you to forgive me of my sin nature. I ask you to come into my heart and be my Lord and Savior. I ask you, to be that Lord and Savior. I surrender to you." You know, the second part of that, you may have made that decision a long time ago, and that's all right. But you've allowed things to cut off that freshness. And so, he's no farther away than a prayer of repentance of saying, "Wow, God, I'm sorry that I've let things interfere with our relationship. And I'm asking you to forgive me. I'm asking you to work powerfully in my life. I'm asking you to draw me closer. And I thank you for it." Whatever situation, if you're here without him, you can leave here with him by inviting him in. If you've grown cold in your relationship, you can rekindle that relationship as you stand there this morning asking him to forgive you and restore the joy of your salvation. You can leave here shouting, hallelujah, I'm on my way to heaven. I'm on my way to heaven. Let's pray together. You make the decisions. You make the choices. Father, help us make good choices. Help us to realize that we are fastly approaching the return of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Help us, Father, to make a commitment to surrender to you, to open our hearts up, if we've never received you, and invite you in to be our Lord and Savior. If we're cold and indifferent, help us repent and ask you to restore the joy of our salvation. Whatever may be the situation, God, speak to our hearts. Father, thank you for all that you do. Thank you for this covering and this safety. And we give you the praise. And we just commit our lives to you. We thank you for the privilege of coming together. And we thank you for all that you do in our lives. And we love you and praise you. Go with us this week and help us be examples to the people that we come in contact with. Help us be witnesses. And help us reflect your glory. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Amen. Turn and wave at somebody. Tell them you love them in Jesus.
Yeah.